Greetings. Welcome to Wickford. My name is Tim Cranston, and I'm the historian here in the village of Wickford. We're here today to take a look at the village of Wickford, how it began, and how it sustained itself across the centuries. Wickford was the brainchild of Lodowick Updike, one of the Narragansett planters. He owned a parcel of land 7 miles wide by 9 miles long, and he used it for agricultural purposes mostly. Updike knew he had something special here: deep water port, protected harbor, and high land that he could build upon. He indeed knew that the shipbuilding industry on Aquidneck Island was fast running out of resources. All the trees across the bay had been cut down, all the resources were depleted, and the shipbuilding industry was looking to expand here in Narragansett Bay. In 1710, Samuel Aborn, a shipbuilder from Massachusetts Bay Colony, settled down in here, and then Benjamin Waterhouse from across in Newport. They set up shop here for the same reason that everybody else who came here did: a great port and lots of resources. Updike himself owned thousands of acres of virgin forest here, great tall oaks and pines here, perfect for building ships. They were right in the shipbuilder's backyard. 5 shipyards opened up, and folks came here to live and work in the shipyards. First, the kind of folks who came here to support the shipyard industry. Specialized blacksmith shops were opened up. Sailmakers came, rope makers came, and woodworkers of all stripes came over here to Wickford to ply their trade here on this island where shipbuilding was the way of the day. A little village sprung up, and then all the services that villages needed came too. Shops and inns and taverns. Before long, Updike's vision for a village had occurred. He started out calling it Updike Newtown, but in the end, he chose Wickford to curry favor with the Connecticut ruling class. Governor Winthrop's wife was born in Wickford, England. He really felt that Rhode Island as a colony was going to cease to exist. He saw his opportunity to make an impression on those folks from Connecticut who he thought would eventually be politically in charge of the area. By the time of the Revolution, Wickford had set itself up. It was the second most important port on the Narragansett Bay, second only to Newport, its sister port across the bay. The British were more interested in Newport. They kind of left Wickford alone, although they came over here in some raiding parties and stole livestock and foodstuffs. Who did come into Wickford was many of those Newport businessmen and traders who had connections over here. They moved their base of operations over here to Wickford so they could continue to do what they did without British interference. So during the Revolution, Wickford prospered while Newport suffered. And after the war was over, Wickford went ahead full steam with almost no damage to the village itself. And as Wickford entered the 1800s, it was a place that was unrivaled here on the southern part of the Narragansett Bay. And even Wickford today, it reeks of prosperity. You walk up and down the streets and you can see the wonderful homes that are still here. You can tell it was a place where people were doing well. Our story that we're going to tell today has to do with those people, the sea captains who lived in these houses. Wickford is a wonderful place in the 20th century. The real deal, a real colonial village. An 18th and 19th century person who lived in Wickford could be brought here and put down on the streets in the 21st century and would feel right at home. It looks exactly as it did in that day. So come with me to Wickford and let's learn about this place through the stories of the sea captain's homes. For many reasons, it makes sense to start our journey right here at the Captain John Updike House. Captain John Updike was the grandson of Lodowick Updike, the gentleman who envisioned Wickford. He envisioned Wickford, as I mentioned, as a grand scheme for him to make some money. Lodowick and then his grandson, Captain John, were the scions of the Updike Smith family. As such, they were the heads of the Updike Plantation. The Plantation Society in southern Rhode Island was no different than the Plantation Society in what we can think about when we think of plantations in the Deep South. The only thing different about it was down there they raised cotton. Up here they raised a wide variety of things, including livestock, grain, and most importantly, dairy farming for the production of cheese. Even in the colonial era, cheese production in New England was one of the most important industries around. These plantations made cheeses in the thousands of pounds. There were extant bills of lading in the Newport Historical Society that talk about one bill of sale of cheese from one Narragansett Planter Society farm of 6,000 and 7,000 pounds. So cheese was big business in here. And Wickford was just a small part of the business of the Updike family, and indeed a new branch of the business, going from an agricultural business enterprise into a real estate enterprise. The Updikes knew they had a gem here with Wickford. Deep water harbor surround this little island, and they knew that they had the opportunity to make a financial killing here in Wickford. What was going on? Why were they thinking about that? Because the shipbuilding industry had used up their raw materials on the East Bay where they began. In Portsmouth, in Bristol, and in Newport, there were no more big trees left. But here on the West Bay, there were acres upon acres of giant chestnuts, oaks, and pines that were perfect for building sailing vessels. So the Updikes knew that there was a ready market for the waterfront, if nothing else, just so shipbuilders could set up here. And indeed, it follows the old saying, if you build it, they will come. And indeed, they did come. Updike platted out the land and began selling the plots of land here in Wickford. And the plots that went first were the waterfront plots, just like this one right here, this plot that he gave to his grandson, John Updike. Now, John Updike built this house to make a statement. As you can see, it's a fine house, and it was built in the style of a colonial Newport mansion. Indeed, he used a Newport architect to design the house. Funny thing, though, about it, its location right now with this wonderful front yard and this beautiful decorative fence does not mirror with anything you'd see in a colonial village. If you walk around Wickford, or if you walk around Providence or Newport, or any of the other colonial villages that still exist in Connecticut, Massachusetts, or Rhode Island, you'll see all the houses are right on the street front. This house is not. Why is this house sitting way back and it has a front yard when no other house does? That tale takes us into the 20th century, when Wickford was becoming a place, a secondary place, again tied to Newport, for the rich and famous of the day to come in summer. Alonzo Cross, the founder of the Cross Pen and Pencil Company, wandered around Wickford as he waited to get over to Newport, fell in love with the village, fell in love with this house. At that time, in the early 20th century, the house was just like the rest of the colonial houses in a village, right on the street front. He really wanted this house, but he couldn't convince his wife to purchase it. She wanted a front yard. Alonzo wanted the house so badly, and he had the financial wherewithal to follow through, that he hired a local architect, historical architect, to supervise the moving of the house back just enough so he could get a front yard for his wife. What a massive undertaking it must be. Take a look at that central chimney stack. Not only is it an impressive mass of brick and stone, but it also is part of the structural support of the house itself. You can't take it down. You can't move it separately. You've got to move the whole house in one piece. So what are they going to do? They came up with an ingenious plan and made a little teeny mini railroad track right here in Wickford in front of this house, jacked the house up very carefully, and placed a rail car underneath the center chimney stack, the great stone structure in the basement, and moved the whole house in one piece back just far enough to sit on the new foundation they had built directly behind it. They then tore down the original foundation for the house, which would have been dressed in rubble stone, filled in the hole, and voila, Mrs. Cross had her front yard. So that's why this house sits in the interesting place that it does, very different from any other colonial home. But let's go back to the time frame we were before, the Updikes. Captain John Updike lived in this house in 1745. He was a sea captain himself, spent a lot of his time in Newport, and lived kind of a life in these two communities, Newport and Wickford. The Updike family wanted this location because of the deep water that was right off the back here. This house was in the front, and behind it would have been a complex of warehouses, stables, docks, piers, and the Updike family sailing ships would tie right up to them. Goods made on the Updike plantation would be loaded onto ships here. Cheeses, grains, livestock, including the Narragansett Pacer horse that was so famous a part of this Rhode Island period. The Updikes would ship from local businessmen as well. Salted codfish, for instance, it was an important export from Wickford Harbor. Coming into the port would be all sorts of goods and services, particularly brick. Fine goods that couldn't be made in the colonies yet, that would have had to come from England and Europe and would be resold here in stores in Wickford. Specific kinds of lumber, window glass, the kind of things that you need to get a new village going. So this was a place where there was an incredible amount of enterprise. When Updike left the area and moved to Newport permanently, he sold the house to Captain Ebenezer Slocum. Another great businessman working in the late 1700s, early 1800s time frame, he was the first person to open up a ferry. His North Ferry was the primary way that folks would get back and forth from the West Bay to Newport and Portsmouth and Bristol. At the same time he was a ferry boat owner, he was a sea captain, and would tie his ships, the Abigail, the Alice, the Mount Vernon, the Dispatch, and the Swift, up at the wharfs and piers of this wonderful facility here. After Ebenezer Slocum was through with the property, he sold it to Captain Jonathan Bates. Now, Jonathan Bates represents another kind of sea captain that we see here in Wickford, as well as Newport, a privateer. Jonathan Bates was a privateer, basically a state-sanctioned pirate who was sanctioned by the British Crown to harass French shipping. He made himself pretty wealthy with his privateer, the Betty. The Betty not only served the British Crown prior to the Revolution, they also, the Betty also flew for the Revolution itself and harassed British shipping eventually. After Bates, Captain James Cooper, Captain Benjamin Davis, these two gentlemen own this property and use it in the same fashion, tying their big three-masted ships and schooners to the wharf immediately behind the house. It was owned by an East Indies trader named Stukely Himes, who ended up using this as his base of operation for his trade between the East Indies. As the 20th century began, the last sea captain to own the home was Captain John Westcott. John Westcott tied his ships, the Fame, the Mary, the Huntress, the Hope, and the Ship Bob, up to the docks behind this house. This is pretty typical of the type of tradition of sea captains owning homes here in Wickford that we'll see today. Behind me, you can see one of those relics of the colonial and federal era, one of the old wharfs that used to be lined with ships coming and going here in Wickford Harbor. There was even an industry on this wharf known as the Holloway Acid Works. The Holloway family were one of the families involved in shipbuilding here, but they also utilized the bark from those logs that were used to build ships and made tannic acid, which was used in the tanning trade. And the tannic acids made here on the acid wharf were shipped right off of the dock and taken to tanneries all up and down the New England coastline. This industry went on for decades. Eventually, it fell out of favor as the tanning industry moved beyond the need for naturally made tannic acids. And then it became a fishing pier. The whole area was filled with fish shacks. Fish shacks were shacks that were rented out to fishermen so they could store their nets and their gear in them when they were off fishing. So some sort of industry went on this location for more than two centuries. We're beginning with the acid factory and the manufacturing of tannic acids, all the way into fishing, which occurred here for another full century with the fish shacks that were located here. So this spot, although it doesn't look like much right now, is an intricate part of Wickford's history. The Baker family is one of the most important families in the history of Wickford and its development as a seaport. Baker men had been sea captains of various stripes across the centuries. The earliest Bakers who came here were fishermen. Additionally, during the Revolutionary War, one of the Bakers, William Baker, was another of Wickford's many entrepreneurs when he realized that the British were blockading the colonies from getting salt. Captain Baker realized that salt was an important commodity, as did the British. Now, the British knew that without salt, one of the primary industries of New England, that being fishing, would come to a standstill. If you can't salt the fish that you catch, you can't ship it out, and you can't make any money. The British knew that, and we think of the British and the Tea Act, but really, the work that the British did trying to blockade both salt and pig iron coming into the colonies was a more effective economic vice for them to put the colonies in than anything else. Baker knew that this was a golden opportunity for him to make money. He knew that fishermen and fish packing houses would pay a premium for salt. Salt was going to be required in the same quantities that it was before the Revolution began. And he outfitted a ship from Wickford Harbor to go down to the Salt Islands, the Turks and Caicos Islands today, and get a load of salt. He enlisted some of the bravest men in the village to do this. As you can imagine, the British just weren't going to step aside and let them land on the islands and get the salt, and went off on various voyages back and forth between Wickford Harbor and the Turks and Caicos Islands. Additionally, Baker hired a number of black sailors here in Wickford, and you don't often think about black sailors in the colonial revolutionary period. Through my research, I've identified at least 20 different black men, some of them former slaves, who worked on the boats that sailed in and out of Wickford. Now, after the Revolution was over, the Baker family took the gains that they made running these salt blockades and started up new businesses. One of them, which ran out of this house with Captain David Baker at the helm, was the ship Resolution, the Rezzo it was known in its day, and that was a regular packet run for decades between Wickford and Providence. All right, now the Baker family was really important to me in my understanding of how the village of Wickford worked. Now, we've got to remember that these men who sailed on these ships went off with no hint of how long they would be gone or when they would be back. There was no communication between a sailing vessel in 1820 and the wife and family back home. So when the last line was cast off, a woman and her children and parents and uncles and aunts would never know when they were going to see their loved ones again. Could be a month, could be a week, could be a year, could be never. It depends upon how the voyage went and what they ran into. So I often wondered, how indeed did these families survive? How did they cope with this in an age when women weren't really doing the kind of business things that a family would need to do to survive? How did this work out? So as I looked in depth at the Baker family and how they ran their business enterprise, I began to understand. At a specific time frame in the, say, around the 1820s to 1830s, we had William Baker Jr., and David S. Baker, along with William Cotter, who lived in the house right across the street, who was the son-in-law to the Baker family and married to one of the Baker gals, operating as what I call a business syndicate. Now, the syndicate is my word, not theirs. I don't know what they called it. What these folks did, these sea captains did at that time frame, was four sea captains owned three ships, three sailing vessels at any given time. Now, a sailing vessel's life was expectancy was only maybe 10 or 12 years. So if you go across a span of time, you'd see they owned many more. But at any given time, they owned three vessels, which they owned together jointly. So all three ships were always running. But one of these captains, one of these interrelated captains, was always on land. He would stay here and take care of the affairs of his extended families here, his extended families, which were also his business partners. So he made sure that things went all right for the four families that he was in charge of while he was here. When one of the Baker ships came back, the captain that was on it would get off. And the captain, the Baker family captain who had been at shore, would jump on that ship and off it would go. These syndicates operated in this fashion. In this way, one captain, one man, one family leader was always home here, taking care of the needs of the extended family, which was also the extended business that they worked together. And the other three captains with their three ships were out at sea making money for the whole group. Based upon this premise, I was able to then figure all the rest of it out. And as I look farther, I see that these same kind of things occurred in other villages, just like Wickford. Places like Nantucket or New Bedford, where the vast majority of the men of age were off at sea. These villages had to continue functioning, and that's exactly how it occurred. So for me, the Baker family was critical in understanding how Wickford worked. This is the Alexander Hewling House. It was constructed in 1768, probably by Robert Potter, who lived right across the street. He was a master housewright in the village in that period, just before the Revolution, and he built many of the homes here. It's also known as the Wickford House, which is the name of the business that Alexander Hewling began here in the 1700s. Now, we spent a lot of time here in Wickford talking about maritime syndicates and how they made life easier for sea captains, maximizing their profits in their businesses and keeping their families safe and taken care of while they were gone. Captain Alexander Hewling was a part of the biggest maritime syndicate on the Narragansett Bay. He was a sea captain for the Browns of Providence, and he was the captain of the three-masted ship, the Lucinda, which sailed out of Providence carrying cargo back and forth to West Africa, the Caribbean, and back here to Rhode Island. Now, you can imagine, if you know anything about history, that those three legs of that particular triangle correspond with the triangle trade. And indeed, it is expected that Hewling's ship, which he's listed cargoes of rum going out and molasses coming back, certainly had a third leg where slaves went from West Africa to the Caribbean. Africa in the late 1700s and early 1800s was a world ruled by various chieftains, and really it was divided up into tribal regions. These warring tribes would bring the men that they captured in their wars to the shorelines of West Africa and trade them for rum. Now, it wouldn't be long before Alexander Hewling and his ship, the Lucinda, which left the Narragansett Bay loaded with Rhode Island rum, would be reloaded with African slaves. Now, the African slaves were then hauled back across the Atlantic Ocean to the Caribbean, where they were sold to the plantation owners there. These plantations were involved in the growing of sugarcane. Indeed, many of the plantations in the Caribbean were owned by the same folks who owned the rum distilleries up here in the Narragansett Bay. So now a ship would be loaded with molasses and make the last leg of the triangle back up to the Narragansett Bay, where the molasses would be offloaded in places like Newport, Providence, Bristol, and indeed Wickford. As anybody might know, molasses is the main ingredient in the manufacture of rum. So the triangle is completed. The three commodities, rum, molasses, and slaves, made up a profit plan for the ship's owners, the ship's captains, and the investors who were involved in this terrible business. According to Hewling family history, while he was on the Lucinda, making that leg from the Caribbean back up to the Narragansett Bay, on the shores of Cape Hatteras, they ran into a horrible gale. His ship got afoul in this terrible weather, was going broadside, his sails were being rent by the wind and the sea, and he looked up to the Lord, according to the story, and said, "If I get out of this, God, I'll give up this life." And somehow he did. Somehow he got his ship turned around, got her headed into the seas, and weathered the terrible gale. He took his ship, it limping up into the Narragansett Bay, tied it up at the Brown family docks in Providence, and walked off to Lucinda for the last time. Alexander had to come up with a new plan, a new way to support his family. He had a large addition built on the back of this house and turned the Alexander Hewling family home into the Wickford House, perhaps the most famous and long-lasting inn and tavern that existed on the lower Narragansett Bay. The large addition in the back included a larger kitchen, more rooms for visitors, and an upstairs ballroom. Imagine the scene here at that time frame. The late 1700s, you've come down here to Wickford to perhaps see how the progress is being made on your ship that's being constructed in one of the shipyards. You could stay here at the Wickford House and in the evening take your wife upstairs and dance the waltz or the minuet to the little orchestra that we'd be playing here. In the back, Hewling had a large stable built. He didn't run the stable. What he did was very typical for the time frame. He leased the stable building out to a stable keeper who ran it as a separate business. So if you came down here from Boston in your horse and carriage, not only were you taken care of, the stable keeper would take care of your horse and fix whatever might need to be fixed on your carriage while you were here visiting in Wickford and enjoying yourself in this fine seaport community. Captain Alexander Hewling's life was quite a bit different as an innkeeper here in the village. It was a safe and prosperous business that he ran here, and towards the end of his days, he sold off the Wickford House to a relative of his wife, Captain Nathan Brown, who was really going through the same process that Hewling was, giving up a life at sea and finding a new way to raise his family here in the village of Wickford. Captain Nathan Brown took over the reins of the Wickford House and ran it throughout the remainder of his days. The Wickford House lived on into actually the 20th century as a very important inn here in the village of Wickford. Behind me stands the imposing circa 1770 tavern house of Captain Daniel Fones. When it was constructed some 245 years ago, it was the largest building in the village. Daniel Fones, he was born in Jamestown, Rhode Island, but moved over here with his family at a very young age and came over here to what was then called Kingstown and settled on a piece of farmland just a little bit north of Roger Williams' famed trading post location. By the age of 12, he wanted to go to sea. He started out as a cabin boy and was like a true hawse piper, worked his way all the way up to a master's rating by the age of 27. About the same time that Fones was achieving his master's rating, the colony of Rhode Island was busy constructing its first real naval warship, the Tartar. Now, in 1740, when the Tartar was finally launched, its first captain is somebody who brings a lot of pride to my family. I'll call him Uncle John, Uncle John Cranston, actually the younger brother of my direct ancestor, Governor Samuel Cranston. Colonel John Cranston, he was the first master of the ship Tartar. Colonel John was a privateer, just like everybody else who was master of this sailing vessel. And he also captured the first prize the Tartar ever caught, the French merchant ship, the Societe. Colonel John, Uncle John, he took the prize from that capture and left the Tartar. And it went through a few captains until Captain Daniel Fones took over the helm of the Tartar in 1744. Now, a privateer is really nothing more than a pirate with a piece of paper. Now, that piece of paper is a letter of marque from a standing government. In this case, the King of England gave Daniel Fones permission to become essentially a pirate against French shipping. They were at war with each other and had been really for years now. The king knew a good way to fight the French was to enlist some of the talented mariners here in the Narragansett Bay to fight the battle for him. Fones and the Tar Tower are perfect examples of this. In 1745, Fones' big break came with the Louisbourg expedition. Now, the Louisbourg expedition was a sortie divined by the British government. Now, they knew that the French colonies up in what we now call Canada were getting a little expansionist in mind. They put together this expedition, a number of vessels carrying soldiers up to attack the fort at Louisbourg, escorted by the warships of the colonies. The Tartar from Rhode Island, a couple of Connecticut warships, and a couple of Massachusetts warships. They set out from here and headed towards Canada. After the troops were offloaded downstream of the fort, the Tartar and two of the Connecticut warships were assigned to take up the rear guard to kind of watch for what might come. Now, the French, they knew this was going to happen. And they sent out an ingenious ploy. They sent out very small ships as soon as night came. Small, small vessels and tiny Indian canoes came towards the first Connecticut warship and threatened to overwhelm her. As the Native Americans and the French climbed aboard her, Fones saw what was going on. He spun the Tartar around and came over to the rescue, repulsing the attack on the Connecticut warship, saving the day, as it were. Indeed, Captain William Sheffield, one of the officers on that ship, and writing a letter home, stated that Fones really saved the entire expedition. If their position had been overwhelmed by the French and Indians, the expedition would have been lost. After the fort was taken, the Tartar and her crew were assigned to stay on and guard Louisbourg from the French, who would surely be coming to take the fort back. And he took advantage of the opportunity and captured a number of French merchant ships while there. Among them, the Duomi, a giant French merchant ship that was sent there to resupply the area. Now, Fones had a special arrangement with the government of Great Britain. This is how it worked. Of all the stuff on the Duomi, the value of it was calculated, and Fones got 1/8 of that value. His officers got 1/4 of it, and the remaining 5/8 was divided up amongst his crew. Finally, the Crown released Daniel Fones and the Tartar to head back to Rhode Island. They came back to the Narragansett Bay heroes. And Daniel Fones eventually stepped off the Tartar. But he wasn't done privateering. He immediately set forth on 3 other privateers that were working in the area in succession, all of them during the French and Indian Wars. As the captain of all of these vessels, he was successful at raiding French shipping. And by the end of the French and Indian War, had amassed quite a fortune for himself. In 1760, Daniel Fones had had enough of the sea. He then took some of his well-earned gains at privateering and had this fine tavern house constructed. Now, its location, the very first tavern after you got off the docks at Wickford, made it a certain fact that this was the first place that any sailor or mariner would step into as he walked up the streets. Now, they came here with only a few things in mind: a flagon of ale, a good drink of Rhode Island rum, and perhaps a comely lass or two. I'm sure they sat back and listened to Captain Daniel Fones, now Tavern Master Daniel Fones, tell his tales of piracy during the French and Indian Wars, of prizes caught, of warships fought. Daniel Fones' tavern house went on and was an important part of the North Kingstown landscape after that as well. As the largest meeting place in town, all of the early town meetings were held here in the big tavern room. At the end of Fones' life, it was sold off to one of the families who really brought Wickford into the 19th century, the Fowler family. Benjamin Fowler, who bought the house from the Fones family, had a unique wedding gift for his namesake grandson, Benjamin Fowler Spink. He gave him the tavern house to run here. Benjamin Fowler Spink used the house a little differently, though. He ran his tavern house down here on the bottom floor, but he rented out the upper floor to a school, actually the first school that opened in the area. The school only operated in the evenings. Folks who lived around here wanted their kids to work during the day. If you're going to get an education, you were going to get it at night. The kids would come here to the third floor of this building and learn their reading, writing, and arithmetic from the teacher who opened up shop here. In the end, Benjamin Fowler Spink's daughter married an important cabinet maker from Newport. He came here too and set up shop in the back in a cabinet maker's shop. He was one of 2 cabinet makers working in this village, and these 2 gentlemen were responsible for the very fancy, ornate doors that graced the streets of Wickford.
We're
We're here at the Sam Phillips House, a fine center chimney, Wickford-style colonial, built in 1773 for Sam Phillips, a member of the prominent Phillips family, probably the second most prominent family in the early years of Wickford. It's a great vehicle for talking about two different kinds of sea captains that inhabited the village. First and foremost, Sam Phillips, whose sea captain career really was in the military. And then afterwards, Constantine Lufrio, a packet master who owned the house after Sam Phillips passed on. First, let's talk about Sam Phillips. He had a remarkable career during the Revolution. He spent the first 2 years of the American Revolution, signed up immediately in the American Continental Army, served in the Revolution here for 2 years, saw service in Newport and the surrounding areas here on the West Bay. After his two-year stint was up, Sam wasn't done. He then immediately signed up with the Continental Navy. His ships were the ship Tartar, the ship Mifflin, and the ship Assurance, three of the most important sailing vessels of the Revolutionary War era. Probably the thing he is most famous for was his involvement in the capture of General Prescott over in Newport. Now, Phillips and some of the other leaders of the Continental Navy here in Rhode Island caught wind of the fact that Prescott's men had captured a prize, a French merchant ship that was loaded with wine and other fine spirits. Now, Phillips and his cohorts realized that these British and Hessian soldiers over there in Newport were going to take advantage of this wonderful cargo and planned their assault to Newport accordingly. The night after the ship was seized, they went over in three longboats from the side of the bay, snuck across in the dark of night, and walked right into the British headquarters in Newport and pulled General Prescott right out of his bed and hauled him away in his nightshirt back over to the West Bay, where he was thrown in jail in Westerly, later transferred to Warwick. Eventually, Prescott was traded and bartered for important Revolutionary War officers who had been captured by the British. And forevermore, Sam Phillips was known as one of the masterminds of this bold venture across the bay to capture the very first British general during the War of the Revolution. Now, after Sam Phillips passed on, he did spend the rest of his life here, married into the Wall family, another prominent Wickford clan. After he passed on, the house was sold to Constantine Lufrio. Now, we think about folks who were settling in Rhode Island and all of New England states in that time frame, and we might think they're all going to be your typical British and English types of folks coming over here. But Constantine Lufrio was a different sort of character and must have seemed like quite an exotic fellow over here. Of mixed Portuguese and Spanish ancestry, he was actually born in St. Augustine, Florida, in the Spanish colony down there. His family moved to Baltimore, where he was raised. Constantine Lufrio earned his master's license in Baltimore, and indeed came up here in Wickford as part of a business scheme. He left his son John down in Baltimore, his adult son John down in Baltimore, came up here to Wickford, bought this house, and set up a packet run. A packet run is a regular scheduled sailing run between two important ports. And in this case, a regular run went from Wickford to Baltimore on a pretty much weekly basis. Now, Baltimore, a big city with lots of needs, offered a ready market for the salted codfish that was coming into the docks at Wickford. The agricultural products were being grown here, as well as lumber and such. You could also go up to a packet ship, and if you wanted to get to Baltimore, pay Constantine Lufrio a fare and ride from Wickford to Baltimore, and vice versa. If you were coming from Baltimore, you wanted to end up in the Narragansett Bay, you could come the other way. Now, Constantine Lufrio lived here and married again into the Wall family, just like Sam Phillips had before. Eventually, Constantine Lufrio had a new ship made, and he named it after his wife Elizabeth and his son John. And his ship, the Elizabeth and John, was a regular sight going up and down the East Coast between Wickford and Baltimore. So as you can see, packet masters were an important part of the sea captain's life here in the village. We spent an awful lot of time today talking about maritime syndicates, those complex business relationships that the sea captains that lived in Wickford entered in to not only maximize the profits that they could get from their sailing vessels, but also to make sure that their families were safe and protected while they were off at sea. Here at the Wall Bailey Double House, we're presented with a perfect opportunity to talk about the second half of that equation, keeping your family safe while you're off at sea. Now, first and foremost, what's a double house? Typically, it's the colonial or federal period version of a duplex of today. Most of them were built at the same time. These double houses are actually houses that are not connected at all internally. Only on the external portions are they connected. This house, though, is a little different, and it plays into our story. The Daniel Wall side of the house was built in 1802, and the George Bailey side of the house was built in 1809. Now, why did that happen? In 1800, George Bailey and Daniel Wall were two sea captains living in Newport, working together in one of these maritime syndicates. They owned probably three sailing vessels and kept them running all the time. George Bailey stayed in Newport, but Daniel Wall moved with his family over here to Wickford in 1802 and had this great house constructed here. But in 1809, the unthinkable happened. Daniel Wall sailed out of Wickford on his sailing vessel and never came back. No one knows what happened to him. No reports were ever given of what happened to his ship, where it foundered, where it sank. Now, Anna Wall here went from being the wife of a successful and wealthy sea captain to being the widow Anna Wall. Really, her options were only two. One was what was essentially a marriage of convenience. She could marry a widower here in town, or she could end up in the town poor farm with her children. But George Bailey came forth and offered her a third option. George Bailey came over with his family in 1809 and built on the other half of this property that they owned. Not only did he do that, but he paid the widow Anna Wall a good sum of money for the small strip of land that existed between the two houses. And then he went down with her to the town hall and drew up a legal document called a planking in agreement, whereby he would pay Anna Wall a yearly stipend for the right to plank his home into hers. In other words, to connect them together. In this fashion, Anna Wall was able to stay in the house, utilizing the money given to her every year by George Bailey. Stayed here until her son, Daniel Jr., grew up and became the village tinsmith. Now, if you're from my generation or beyond, that name George Bailey rings a bell with you. It'll tie into a movie that has an awful lot to do with Christmas and angels. Now here, I think George Bailey is the real angel. He really had no legal requirement to come over here and do what he did to protect the widow Anna Wall's future. But he did it because they were in this maritime syndicate. It was a business relationship for sure between Daniel Wall and George Bailey, but it was also a personal relationship. And an interesting aside, this house, one half built in 1802 and the other half built in 1809, is still owned by a direct descendant of the widow Anna Wall. We're here on Washington Street to talk about Charles Short. Now, Charles Short was a whole different kind of a maritime captain during the time frame when those maritime syndicates were operating. Now, Charles Short was not involved in any of these maritime syndicates. He really was kind of a sea captain who worked freelance. Charles Short sailed on different ships. When one of the captains was sick or something, he couldn't go out, they'd hire Charles Short. Charles worked on the Sloop Delight, the Sloop Eagle, the Nancy and Polly, the Mount Moriah, the Swift, the General Washington, the list goes on and on. As soon as Charles Short got home, often he would go back out. He didn't have the protection of a syndicate of folks to work within, and he just had to keep working in order to keep his family operating financially. Now, this had some downsides, as we kind of talked about a little bit, at the houses where folks did work within these maritime syndicates. Charles' wife and family, his wife's name was Sarah, were alone all the time. They were left to their own devices, really, here in an age when there was no communication and nobody to help Sarah through the hard times that would occur in a colonial village like this. And one day, the worst thing that could possibly happen happened to Charles when he came home. Sarah wasn't here. Sarah left and went off with another man. And now Charles, who had been working hard to try to protect his family, had no family to come home to. Of course, now Charles had to get a divorce. He went over to Newport, took out an ad in the Newport Mercury that said, "My wife Sarah has left my bed and I am divorced from her. All of her debts I refuse to pay from now on." And that's it. That's a divorce in the colonial era. So this really just goes to show you how important those maritime syndicates were, not only for making sure that their vessels could always be sailing, but also so that their families could stay together when the captains were off at sea. Now, the captain that lived in this house behind us, Peleg Whiteman, he started out in 1870 as the master of the steamer that ran on the Newport and Wickford line. For most of that time frame, it was the steamer General. He would walk out his front door here, down the street, and climb aboard the General each day for its multiple trips back and forth between Newport and Wickford. He could always see his house from the wheelhouse of the General as he came back into the harbor. And at the end of his day, he'd climb off the ship and walk back to his home. I imagine that all the sea captains who were still living here in that time had a little bit of envy for the life of Peleg Whiteman. And there were sea captains like that in Wickford even into the 1700s. Packet masters who had established a run that allowed them to spend more time at home with their family. Now, Peleg Whiteman, as the captain of the General, would have met every one of the movers and shakers in the United States of America. All of the captains of industry in the country at that time frame would use the General to get over to Newport. He would have shook hands with Rockefellers and Astors. The Vanderbilts would have known Peleg Whiteman by his first name. Another person that Peleg Whiteman most certainly met on the General was Newport architect James Flutter. Peleg Whiteman hired James Flutter to have this house constructed for him in 1880. He moved in with his wife, Catherine, who was a Babcock, and Catherine's niece, Melissa. For Peleg Whiteman, at least with his niece, Melissa, he made that okay. The Babcock family offered to give up some cash towards the construction of the house if they would include a small apartment in it for Melissa to spend her days in. And that's what happened. Flutter designed this house in the style of a Newport house of the time with a little apartment for Melissa to live in. What a great location for the Whitemans. As I said, Peleg could look out the window and see the General. And Catherine, his wife, could see him coming and going on each of the many trips he took each day back and forth between Wickford and Newport. And in that fashion, Peleg Whiteman lived out his life. And he died in the way that only a sea captain would want to die. In a February storm, as he was working to get the General back into the harbor here in Wickford, across from Newport, he was standing at the helm, guiding her into the harbor, and he had a massive heart attack. He dropped dead right there on the wheelhouse of the General, and his second mate had to bring the vessel home. Now, I've read a lot of obituaries over the years. I've scanned through a lot of microfilm and seen them, and by and large, they're all pretty boring. But Peleg Whiteman's obituary is a bit different. The obituary writer at that time at the Providence Journal must have had designs upon being a romance novelist, because the obituary he wrote for Peleg Whiteman, the famous sea captain down here in Wickford, was a little bit different. I'd like to read it for you, if I may. On a dark and cheerless night of 16 February, while wind and wave were indulging in a chant as weird as the witch's incantation, the spirit of our esteemed captain, in obedience to the supreme will, winged away on its flight to a home beyond the sea. For him, the storms are over. God gave, he took, he will restore. Boy, you can't beat that. Now that's an obituary that every sea captain could be proud of. Roland Mason had this fine house built for his retirement home in 1902. Now, the Mason family came here at the beginning of the 19th century to be involved in the most noxious and despised business enterprise that ever existed in Wickford Harbor. The Masons and their company out of Fall River bought Cornelius Island and opened up a fish oil factory there. Now, the Masons would purchase fish that fishermen would catch in their nets that they weren't interested in selling, take them along with Menhaden, and press them to create fish oil. Now, fish oil was like poor man's whale oil. People would use them to light their homes, and it was also involved and utilized in industry, in the annealing of steel, in the beginning of the steel industry. So there was a ready market for fish oil, and the Masons were going to take advantage of the fact that Wickford was a place where so much fish was coming in. So they're making this product, this fish oil, and they're putting it in casks and shipping it out. And we've got this waste product, crushed fish. What are they going to do with it? And in a good Swamp Yankee fashion, they decided they weren't going to waste it. They would take the crushed fish and mix it with seaweed. And also they said, what the heck, let's make us a really good product. They paid young people to collect guano. Now, we all know what guano is. That's the business that comes out of the wrong end of a bird. And mix that all together and make a fertilizer, a natural fertilizer product, which they would sell to farmers. So you've got this process going over there on the island in the midst of the summer heat, where they're taking fish guts and seaweed and guano and mixing it all together and selling it to farmers. They'd stockpile it over there and sell it in the spring and in the fall, the time that farmers would be fertilizing their fields. So every spring and every fall, there was a parade of farmers coming from western Rhode Island, from Coventry, from Exeter, from western North Kingstown, down to Cornelius Island. At low tide, they could get on Cornelius Island, going across a narrow spot from Camp Avenue. Then they'd load up their carts full of this noxious fish oil, guano, seaweed mix, and haul it through the village back to the farms. Now, as you can imagine, folks didn't like that at all. And eventually, the residents of Wickford got together and kind of hijacked the town financial meeting and came in with, just like in an old Frankenstein movie, with their pitchforks and their sticks, and said, "We want that operation shut down." The politicians, being brave and strong as they did, caved in immediately and issued an order to the sheriff of Washington County to go and shut the business down as a public nuisance. The Washington County sheriff went over to Cornelius Island and told them to close down. Most of the folks working there closed up shop and went back to Fall River, but the Mason family stayed here. Roland Mason basically grew up at the helm of a ship. By the time he was 16, had a master's rating and was a captain of a menhaden fishing boat of his own. He fished for his entire lifetime as a menhaden fisherman out of Wickford here. Now, Roland was a sea captain in the classic sense. He loved being at sea, the sea was his home, and he loved spinning tall tales about the sea. Towards the end of his life, he decided that he needed a new tall tale to tell, and he sat his daughter down and told her, she was a good mathematician, he told her how many barrels of menhaden he had caught over the course of his lifetime, as he did keep meticulous notes, how long the average menhaden was, how many menhaden would fit in one barrel, told her to sit down here and calculate how long of a string of menhaden, if they were laid nose to tail, would that make. Roland Mason's daughter calculated that would be enough menhaden to circle the globe 38 times. That was one of his favorite stories. Roland would tell that story for time immortal. Anybody who would stop and listen, he'd tell the story of how he caught enough menhaden in his lifetime to circle the globe 38 times. Roland Mason, in his retirement, wasn't going to retire. He wasn't that kind of guy. He had worked at sea from the age of 14 up until he gave up going to sea because of his age and started a whole new business. He got in on the ground floor of oyster farming. Roland Mason and his partners were doing aquaculture here in Wickford before there even was aquaculture. They were farming oysters in Narragansett Bay and in the Long Island Sound and canning them at two oyster canneries at the end here of Pleasant Street. Indeed, Wickford oysters were some of the most famous oysters in their day. Over in Newport at those posh parties and down in New York City in the fancy hotels and up in Boston, everybody was wanting to be eating Wickford Harbor oysters. And Wickford Harbor oysters were the largest employers in the period in the early 1900s, employing more than 50 or 60 people out either tending to the oyster farms or shucking the oysters and packing them up for shipment to all these wonderful establishments up and down the East Coast. So Wickford Harbor became famous in the early 20th century more for its oysters than for its sea captains. We're here at the Lewis Brothers houses, a group of houses that were all owned by three remarkable late 1800s fishermen. The first thing you need to learn about the Lewis brothers is that they were swamp Yankees through and through. They were proud of their French heritage, but they're even more proud of the frugal qualities that swamp Yankees possessed. Two of the Lewis brothers got together and decided they were going to build these two fine Victorian-style homes here. Well, they had their wives look at some plans. Of course, the wives looked and picked this and that, and one wife wanted one thing, one wife wanted another. But in the end, the Lewis brothers decided, no, we're only buying one set of plans. Why should we waste our money on a second set of plans? So they had these beautiful Victorian-style homes built here. You'll note, though, that they're built as a mirror image of each other. What's important to remember is the Lewis brothers decided that, we want to save money on our house plans, but I don't want my front door right next to my brother's front door. I don't want him knowing who's coming over to visit me at my house. So how did the Lewis brothers make their money? I mean, they were fishermen, and they fished in an extraordinary way in this time frame. The Lewis brothers took their fishing style and went all the way back to the Native Americans, the Narragansett and Wampanoag Indians, the methods that they used for fishing. And what those folks did and what the Lewis brothers adopted was called trap fishing. It's an ancient style of fishing whereby the fishermen originally at low tides will set up a set of weirs, a set of traps that the fish would swim into at high tide. When the tide goes out, The fish are trapped in the weirs, and the fishermen can come up at low tide in dories and pull the fish out live from these weirs without injuring them, killing them, or damaging them. This gives you some fish that's really valuable, high-quality, marketable fish that you can collect top dollar for. Now, the Lewis brothers took this a step further. These guys were smart. Their main fishing boat, which they imaginatively named the Lewis brothers, designed in a special way with a giant live fish hold. As the Lewis brothers' boat was sailing across the Narragansett Bay, they were able to have the waters of the bay flow through the fish hold, and even food fish would flow through the holes of the fish hold, and the codfish or whatever they were catching could continue to feed and get fresh water flowing across their gills. This great plan allowed the Lewis brothers to catch fish in the fish traps, live and unharmed, and then load them into their boat, the Lewis brothers, and eventually have great high-quality fish that they could then sell at market. Taking it a step further, the Lewis brothers had one of their brothers, there were six of them all together, on shore, calling and checking on the markets all up and down the East Coast. Maybe they were paying better for fish in Boston, or maybe they were paying better for fish in Providence, or in New Bedford, or maybe even New York's Fulton Fish Market. As soon as they found out where they were getting the best price for fish, they would take the Lewis brothers' boat, and on its way it would go, and they would be able to bring a ship full of live fish right up to the docks at wherever it was and sell them at top dollar. And indeed, if you were in the Victorian era in the 1800s eating in a fine restaurant or staying in a hotel in New York City or Boston or Providence, more than likely you could have been eating Lewis Brothers fish caught right here out of Wickford in the Narragansett Bay in these ancient fish traps designed in the style of the Narragansett Indians and manned by the Lewis Brothers. Now, these ingenious swamp jackies then took this another step further. Realizing there was more money to be made with this unique fishing style, they made arrangements with the local hotels and inns in the village of Wickford. And they would have guests come and ride on their boat, the Lewis brothers, and pay them to watch them fish. Talk about it, making money on every angle. So not only were they making top dollar selling their fish at whatever fish market was paying the best, but there were also tourists who came down to Wickford who were paying them to allow them to watch them fish in this ancient style. You gotta hand it to the Lewis brothers, they had every angle covered. Now I hope that you're excited enough about the village after what you've seen to want to come down here. You've listened to me ramble on about Wickford, you come down here and ramble about the place. Keep an eye out for me. I'll probably be here. I hope we cross paths and I can say hello to you in person. Come on down to Wickford and enjoy this fine village.
All the way for the windy weather, boys. All the way, boys. All the way, oh, all the way and pull together, boys. All the way, boys, all the way. All the way for the merchant money, boys. All the way, boys, all the way, oh, all the way and let's get going, boys. All the way, boys, all the way. God made the food, but the devil made the cook, boys. All the way, boys, all the way. And the grub that they give us is worse than it looks, boys. All the way, boys, all the way. God made the bees and the bees made the honey, boys. All the way, boys, all the way. But the devil made the ladies for to rob us of our money, boys. All the way, boys, all the way. All the packets rolling down the river, boys. All the way, boys, all the way. When she rolls down, her topsail shiver, boys. All the way, boys, all the way. I think I heard that first mate say, boys. All the way, boys, all the way. Or take one pull and then belay, boys. All the way, boys, all the way.